just start with a little prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen. Remember, O most compassionate Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O virgins of virgins, our mother. To thee do we come, before thee we stand, sinful and sorrowful. O mother, the word incarnate, despise not our petition, but in thy mercy hear and answer. Our Lady, seat of wisdom and spouse of the Holy Spirit. Saint Joseph, Saint Alphonse Liguori, Saint Leonard of Port Maurice, Saint Pio. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen. So my talk today is on confession and Our Lady of Fatima, how Our Lady came and requested confession. On July 13, 1917, Our Lady appeared for the third time to the three children of Fatima and showed them the vision of hell and made the now famous 13 prophecies. In this vision, Our Lady said that God wishes to establish in the world devotion to her Immaculate Heart, and that she would come to ask for the communion of reparation and First Saturdays. 8 years later, on December 10th, 1925, Our Lady did indeed come back, and she appeared with the child Jesus to St. Lucy in the convent. The child Jesus spoke first, and he said, "Have compassion on the heart of your most holy mother, which is covered with thorns, with which ungrateful men pierce it at every moment, while there is no one to remove them with an act of reparation." Our Lady then said, "My daughter, look at my heart surrounded with thorns, with which ungrateful men pierce it at every moment by their blasphemies and ingratitude. You at least try to console me and say that I promise to assist at the hour of death with all the graces necessary for salvation to all those who on the first Saturday of five consecutive months go to the confession and receive Holy Communion, recite five decades of the Holy Rosary, and keep me company for a quarter of an hour while meditating upon the mysteries of the Rosary with the intention of making reparation to me." So to make confession with the intention of making reparation means that you want to make a good, a valid, and illicit confession. But this must be offered in the spirit of reparation. So in this case, to Mary's Immaculate Heart. So this confession can be made on First Saturdays. But then Sister Lucy explained the difficulty some experience to confess on Saturdays, and asked whether confession made within the preceding octave would suffice. And the child Jesus replied, yes, the confession could proceed even a longer period, provided when they receive me, they be in the state of grace, and the confession is made with the intention of making the reparation to my mother's Immaculate Heart. And so this is very important. So you want to go in there with intention. So you want to make this confession like it's your last confession. You want to make it with a pure heart. And you want to go in there and say, this is going to be the best confession I make. So you want to prepare for this confession. I'm going to walk you through these things on how to make a proper confession today. But first, I want to talk about what has happened since, you know, in the post-conciliar revolution in the church. The church has suffered on every level possible, on levels of doctrines, on levels of, you know, scripture, the liturgy. The devil has attacked every aspect of the church. Vocations. I mean, when you study the statistics, it's devastating. The whole church has been rocked. And very rarely, rarely do you ever hear about the damage done in the confessional. And let me tell you something, my friends. This is where souls are affected more than any other way, probably. Because unfortunately, if you commit a grave mortal sin, mortal means death. Your soul dies. The Holy Trinity flees your soul. And if you commit that sin, the only way you're going to save your soul, you have to make a good confession. And so it's so important. And so the devil has infiltrated this. Most seminaries, they're teaching heretical teachings and morals. Most priests have not been trained properly. And I'm going to tell you something that will shock you, even traditional priests. And I know what I'm talking about because I've done missions for many years throughout the country. And I get in that confessional 12, 15 hours a day when I do it. And I could see, if you want to know where the parish is out here, confessions. It's horrible. The confessional has become a revolving door where so many recidivist sinners are going in committing the same mortal sins. And they have no memory of life. And I'll talk about this more. For 20, 30, I've even 40 years, they go every week to confession, committing the same mortal sin. There's no amendment of life. And I could go on and on. The priest, I could tell you right now, the majority of you here right now, when you go to confession, your penance is three Hail Marys or three Our Fathers. And if that's what you're getting, I could tell you right now, you have the wrong priest. Because the penance is so important. It's medicinal. It's supposed to uproot the vices. It's supposed to fit the crime that you have. So many people say, Father, you know, I committed abortion. The priest gave me three Hail Marys. My head, I want to do reparation. They know, good souls, how many priests, they mock penitents that come in that are trying to be serious, to live a holy life. Oh, that's not a sin. I've had priests tell me that as a priest, and I have to compose myself, say, excuse me, Father, I'm not here to argue. That was a sin. It always was, always will be. And I said, so just, you know, give me my absolution. I was in San Giovanni Rotondo once, many years ago, as a priest that I gave a retreat. And I went to confession, and the priest, when he gave me absolution, he made up the formula. I said, Father, that's not valid. I said, repeat after me. I said, if Padre Pio was here, he'd whack you over the head. He'd have you thrown in prison. Here are penitents coming into the confessional, literally in bondage, and they walk out in more bondage. The priests, it's so common I hear, they could, oh, just tell me one sin and it covers it all. That is heresy, and that does not absolve your sins. I could go on and on. I'm going to be pointing more and more of these things out. It is devastating. The church has this horrible practice for years now. They have these penitent service, they call it, where twice a year before Easter and Christmas, the parishes say, you come and we're going to have this confessions for everybody. They get 10 priests sitting all over in the sanctuary, and they do this nonsense, and they say, so what we're going to do to save time is we're all going to do an act of contrition together so that when you go after you're absolved, you don't do your act of contrition to the priest so we could get everyone in. This is nonsense. Nonsense. And then so many people think they only have to go to confession twice a year. Twice a year. I recommend, my friends, at least once a week if you're serious about saving your soul. And if you want to get all the indulgences that you're capable of getting, you must go to confession 8 days before, 8 days after. So if you go to confession at least every 2 weeks, you will receive all the indulgences, and you want those indulgences. And so I could go, I mean, there's so many things about what's going on. I have a friend who is a priest, I know him over 25 years, and I was visiting him. And he showed me, I saw the bulletin from the chancery. You know what they said? We have discovered that if you have more confessions in your parish, the people give more money. this is the honest truth. So we want you to hear confessions at least 1 hour a week or whatever. 1 hour a week? I mean, so the whole motive was not to save souls, but to bring the cash in. We laugh, but you know what? It is so sad because St. John Vianney said that more souls are won in the confessional than any other means. Because the priest, the penitent enters into the confessional. He's there with Christ, not Father Isaac. He has a direct encounter with God. And God wants to pour out his grace and his mercy upon that soul. But the priest has to be trained properly. When we talk about these crises, Our Lady appeared over 400 years ago in Quito, Ecuador, Our Lady of Good Success, and she warned us. The prophecies, I always tell people, we don't know the third secret all, that wasn't totally revealed, of course, in Fatima. But I said, go back 400 years ago, Our Lady knew they wouldn't reveal it. She gave a lot of the third secret 400 years ago at Quito. And no apparition describes what we're going through today better than Our Lady of Good Success. And I quote Our Lady. She says to Mother Marianne, who's incorrupt to this day, "Woe to the children of these times." That's our times. "It will be difficult to receive the sacrament of baptism, also that of confirmation, making use of persons in position of authority. The devil will make a great effort to destroy the sacrament of penance." I'm going to repeat that. Making use of persons in positions of authority, the devil will make a great effort to destroy the sacrament of penance. And this breaks my heart when I'm going to say now, and that includes our Pope, what he has done to this sacrament and what he has been doing to destroy this sacrament is disgraceful. And we have to pray for his conversion. He's leading souls to hell, my friend. Never in the history of the church has a Pope encouraged people to sin. Never in the history of the church has a Pope encouraged people to say in illicit marriages, committing adultery, and then tell them to go receive the sacrament of penance and the Eucharist. This is blasphemy and heresy. You hear me? Blasphemy and heresy. Amoris Laetitia is a document from hell, my friends. Because there's some good stuff in there, of course, but the devil knows what he's doing. He always gives you a lot of the truth, and then he comes with his lies because he wants to snag you and bring you to hell. It's like I tell people all the time, if you have a piece of chocolate, 99% chocolate, 1% arsenic, what happens when you eat it? You die. You die. The bishops, what they've done to the sacrament of penance is a disgrace. They don't train their seminarians. They don't train their priests. And good priests that are trained properly, which are very few, that follow the great doctor of the church, St. Alphonse, they will persecute that priest. And I'm one of them. And I could tell you I was blessed, you know, through prayers, probably from my mother and others, that I came across a book on St. Alphonse before I came into seminary. And I read that, it changed my life, and I begged Our Lady, if your son wants me to be a priest, when it comes time to study moral theology, I beg you to send me a professor that will teach me St. Alphonse, who is the doctor of the church on morals. And the church tells, confesses, if you follow him, you will not err. What a promise. St. John Vianney said he didn't become a good confessor till he studied the works of St. Alphonse. St. Pio followed only St. Alphonse in the confession. And when I'm a simple man, but when I read that, that's enough for me. And with the grace of God, when I made my first vows and I started studying theology, my order, we had great theologians from the old school, not the new one. And I had a holy professor who was a living saint, God rest his soul, Father Alphonse Sutton. And he taught me and all of us St. Alphonse. And I can't tell you the difference that made in my whole priesthood because you're able to set souls free. Our Lady, Our Lady Good Success, once again emphasized the importance of the sacrament of penance and the weighty role of the priest. And I quote her, Our Lady said, "See and contemplate the grandeur of this restoring and life-giving sacrament of penance, so forgotten and even scorned by ungrateful men in their mad illusions. They do not realize that it is the only sure means of salvation after losing one's baptismal innocence." So when you're a mortal sin, you should never delay. And I'll go over this again. Never. You got to run to the confessional. And I tell the people when I do mission, if you're a mortal sin, I don't care if it's 2 a.m, go knock down the door, the priest's door. Wake up, Father, I'm on my way to hell. And if he doesn't come to help you, he's on his way to hell too. Okay, this is so, so important. And the only way the church teaches, besides the confessional, because in the confessional, you're going to learn you only need contrition, attrition. But if you're dying and there's no priest around, the only chance you have, and it's a long shot, believe me, is to make a perfect act of contrition. Now, that doesn't mean you just recite the formula. You have to have the disposition where you love God so much you don't want to offend him. No mixture of going to hell, fear of going to hell. You're living a wicked life. If you think you could have that disposition without a miracle, your whole eternity depends on it. Because hell only has one entrance, one gate for entrance. There is no exit. You can't come back. You can't. A lady goes on, she goes, what is most grievous is that even the ministers and the most holy son, talking about priests, do not value this sacrament as they should, viewing with cold indifference this precious treasure placed in the hands for the restoration of souls washed in the blood of the Redeemer. This is true, my friends. You go to the average parish, they don't even have, they're lucky to have an hour of confession a week. When I was growing up, I remember the average parish where I live had 4 or 5 priests, at least 3 hours every Saturday afternoon, at least. All of those priests were in the confessional. That's at least 15 hours confession. If you want to be a good priest and a good pastor, you must be in that confessional and dedicate your life to it, because you will make saints of your parishioners if you're a good confessor. But no, they don't even offer it. People are embarrassed. People told me one day, the priest said, you know, I'm in a little bit of a hurry. So anyone, I'll hear confessions, but only if you're a mortal sin. I'm not making this stuff up. And they're, what, are you going to stand up? Hey, here I am. Give me a break. And so, once again, she goes, this precious treasure placed in the hands for the restoration of souls washed in the blood of the Redeemer. The price of sin is devastating. The price of sin, our Lord hung on the cross. Our Lord went through the passion. That's the price of sin. She goes on, these are those who consider hearing confessions futile and a waste of time. Not at all, Our Lady says. She goes, oh, if priests would only recognize this divine gift, seeing clearly that you are now contemplating and being enlightened with the light that now illuminates you, they would recognize this divine gift. They would. And so persons in positions of authority, she said, the devil will use to eliminate this sacrament. And unfortunately, like I said, never in the history of the church has a pope attacked the sacrament as this pope has. And I'm not happy to talk about this, but I have to. I'm obliged. Because believe me, many souls buy into this. And you could say it would never happen to me. I'm too traditional. Yeah, you fall into mortal sin. Your intellect gets dark. Your will gets weak. And you're capable of anything. And sin has an effect where you keep going, going, going. And so, Pope Francis, in Amoris Laetitia, okay, he says this in chapter 8, which is concerning those in bad marriages that are married in the church, they get divorced, no annulment, and enter into another marriage, and they're having, sexual relations, right? The Pope states that a person in this state can, and I quote him, chapter 8, be living in God's grace, can love, and can also grow in the life of grace and charity while receiving the church's help to this end. So what kind of, that's the end of the quote, but what kind of help from the church is the Pope talking about? And he tells us in footnote number 351, and I quote the Pope, in certain cases, this can include the help of the sacraments. Hence, I want to remind priests that the confessional must not be a torture chamber, but rather an encounter with the Lord's mercy. I would also point out that the Eucharist is not a prize for the perfect, but a powerful medicine and nourishment for the weak. My friends, this is so bad, so bad. It's beyond that a pope would talk about this. These people are immortal. The help of the church is when a soul like that comes to the confessional, to Father. I show this soul compassion. I show the soul mercy. But mercy, compassion, and charity can never be separated from the truth. So if I'm really, truly going to be a merciful priest, I can't send you out of that confessional and thinking you're absolved, and technically you're not because you're an occasion of sin. I'll go over this. I'm sending you to hell. I mean, you walk out this false hope. Oh, yeah, everything's all right. And the Pope has reinforced this many times, like we heard yesterday from John about the woman living in a bad marriage like this, where he called her on the phone and said, don't worry, you can go to communion, but, just go to another parish. And this has been confirmed recently that the Pope has come out and it's been verified that he says this is the only true interpretation of Mors Letitia. Yes, these people can go to confession and communion. But I can't absolve someone like that. When that person, I'm going to administer God's mercy and God's compassion, but I'm going to say, sir or miss, okay, you have to separate. You are living in a state of mortal sin. If you die, you will lose your soul. And you have patience, you instruct them, but you can never absolve that person in the proximate occasion, voluntary sin, without telling them they have to go home, you move out, and then you come back to Father, and then we'll talk about absolution. But the Pope is encouraging this constantly. I mean, the Pope, in his... at the beginning of the year of mercy, all right, he says to the missionaries of mercy, these are priests that are supposed to minister the mercy of God. He says this, he says, if someone comes to you and feels something must be removed from him, he's talking about sin, but perhaps he's unable to say it, what isn't verbally, but you understand, it's all right, he says, He says it this way, with a gesture of coming. So he's saying that he don't have to verbally say it. With his gesture of coming, he's saying it. He says that's the first condition. The second is he's repentive. If someone comes to you, it is because he doesn't want to fall in these situations, but he doesn't dare say it. He's afraid to say it and then not be able to do it. But if he cannot do it, and the Lord understands these things, the language of gestures, have open arms to understand what is inside the heart that cannot be said or said this way, somewhat because of shame. You understand me? You must receive everyone with the language with which they can speak. This makes me weep, literally. What are you doing to these poor souls that have cut themselves off from God? In the Council of Trent, my friends, made very clear that this position is condemned and those who hold it are anathematized. This is the Council of Trent. It says in canon number 4, if anyone deny it, that for the entire and perfect remission of sins, there are required 3 acts in the penitent, which are, as it was, the matter of the sacrament of penance. Number 1, contrition, 2, confession, and satisfaction, which are called the 3 parts of penance. Or if anyone says that there are 2 parts only of penance, the terrors with which the conscience is smitten upon being conceived of sin, and the faith generated by the gospel or by the absolution whereby one believes that his sins are forgiven him through Christ, let him be anathema. My friends, this is bad news, because you are obliged to confess your sins. Unless you can't speak, then that's the only other time, then he has to write it out, the penitent. The only other time where you could absolve someone, you know, somebody, you know, they're unconscious in the hospital, you anoint them conditionally, so on and so on. But sometimes the man could hardly speak. He could show that he is sorry. But these are rare circumstances. But you must confess your sins. And when they're mortal, you must confess species and number. The species, different kinds of mortal sins. And then how many times? You have to do it. And if you don't remember exactly, you tell the priest, well, I have an idea. Maybe I did it every day, two times a week, but I confess the number in God's eyes. But without that confession, and believe me, souls come in, good souls, and they're terrified. But a good confessor will know how to dispose that soul, to encourage him. And you encourage him, say, my son, you know, you came here today, all heaven's rejoicing. Please, I'm going to help you make a confession. I will do everything to help you. But don't let the devil get hold of you. You tell me everything, and I'm going to help you. And you help them like that. You show them passion. St. Alphonse Liguori tells us that there's four qualities of a good confessor. Number one, the confessor is a judge. You hear this? And the Pope Francis is constantly telling priests as confessors, do not judge. What do you think you're kneeling for when you go into confession and the priest is sitting for? He's judging. He's in that position to judge. He has to. I have to judge. Is this mortal? Is this venial? He's a judge. The church has always said that. Number two, the priest is a teacher. He teaches you how to walk in the way of holiness. It says in the Bible, only a fool guides himself. You don't want to be a fool, do you? And so that priest will teach you, and his main job is, say, to identify. If you're here sitting here and you don't know your prominent vice, you have a lousy confessor. Because the whole thing is to identify your prominent vice and uproot it by its roots, that you'd rather die than ever commit that sin again. So he'll teach you and how to do these things. The next is he's a physician of the soul. So important. When you go to the doctor, what does he do? He diagnoses what? Your disease. And then he tells you, he don't just say, go home, you're going to die, and there's nothing I could do for you. They give you prescription. They give you medicine. And a good confession is the physician of the soul to give you counsel, but also now, and that's part of the penance, is to root up that vice. When you just get in three Hail Marys, it's doing you no good. So you want to, with your confessor, if he's not doing it, say, Father, help me uproot my vice. Give me specific remedies. The penance should be geared to rooting up that vice that you have, that you keep on falling into. And that's why I beg you to pray to the Blessed Virgin Mary. She wants you in heaven more than you want. Say, please, Blessed Mother, find me a steady confessor, because the greatest gift you could have, my friends, is to go to the same priest who knows the truth and who will be compassionate and kind, but will tell you the truth and will not give in to human respect and will help you uproot your vice. So that's, and the last is he's a compassionate father. That when the prodigal son, when he went astray, when he came back, when his father saw him at a distance, he didn't become arrogant. He ran towards his son. He embraced him and put a ring on his finger, shoes on his feet, which all symbolizes aspects in the spiritual life, but we can't get into that. But the bottom line is that's a good confessor. St. Alphonse tells you, you never yell at a penitent in a confessional. The only time you get strong is when someone comes there and mocks the sacrament or is getting out of line. Sometimes you have to get a little strong, but there's no place for that. You've got to be a compassionate father. But a compassionate father, once again, has to stick to the truth and what the church has always taught. And it's very, very important, these things. And so you should be encouraged to pray and find a confessor that has those qualities and studies moral theology. St. Leonard Port-Maurice tells us, and I recommend you want to do yourself a favor. This book is called Counsel to Confessors. It is gold. Get this, not so much for you, you can read, but get it for your priest. Because any priest that's not following this is not doing right in the confessional, believe me. And I'm going to read from him what he tells you that he takes things from the doctors, the fathers, what has been taught by the Holy Sees, the popes, consistently. And it works because this is what St. Alphonse teaches. So you get your priestess as a gift. It'll be the greatest gift that you give them, believe me, and it will help save your soul. And St. Leonard of Port Maurice, in this book, he tells us that to the prudence of the confessor, it chiefly belongs to ascertain his penitent to be an habitual or relapsed sinner. If he be in the proximate occasion of sin, and if he has an explicit knowledge of those mysteries which are bound to know by the necessity of means to an end. St. Leonard goes on, he says, I desire to place before you those principles of moral theology only, which have been universally adopted by all the doctors, confirmed by the authority of holy fathers, and especially which have been unalterably fixed by the infallible decisions of the Holy See. Propositions which the church has condemned now. He's saying these have been condemned by Holy Mother Church. Number one regards the habitual sinner, the penitent who has the habit of sinning against the law of God, of nature, or of the church. Even if there appears no hope of amendment, is not to be denied absolution or to be put off, provided he professes orally that he is sorry and proposes the amendment. This is condemned. So they could say they're sorry, but if if there appears to be no hope of amendment, that he's going to continue in their sin, you cannot absolve this person. And this is what they're being taught. This condemnation they teach in the seminary, that this is what you're supposed to do. Absolve everyone. I've been yelled out by bishops and everything, and I can't defend myself because the seal of confession. How dare you delay absolution? And you sit there with your head down. He's like, whatever. You know? Number two, this is condemned. He says, he can sometimes be absolved who remains an approximate occasion of sin, which he can and does not wish to omit, but rather directly and professly seeks to enter into. And an occasion of sin, approximate, is something where, like, you don't want to remove. Like, say today, one of the biggest problems, my friend, is the internet with pornography. No priest can absolve that man or woman that's doing that until they go home and remove the occasion. And so when I'm here in confession, I say, oh, you got that problem. All right, we're going to help you here. I'm a physician of the soul, and so I'm going to give you remedies. And this, before I could give you absolution, you must remove the occasion. You're going to go home. You're going to get a filter on your computer that doesn't allow known purity. You're going to have someone else put the code in it so you don't know the code. All right? And then I give him remedies. I say, you're going to meditate on the four last things, at least one of them every day, 15 minutes. Because the fear of hell will keep you out of hell. All right? I give them all other penance, all other remedies for their vice. And then you come back. And when you come back, you could get absolution if you fulfill these things. All right? Otherwise, the Pope, nobody can absolve someone in approximate occasions of sin, voluntary one. You cannot. You're not going to be forgiven. It won't be valid. And so when these people do it, they get free. They get free. Because what happens, and trust me, I'll say to him, okay, what happened? What did the last priest tell you? He goes, well, he told me to go home and get rid of it. I said, and what happened? I know what happened. I said, what happened? Well, I went home and I got weak because I saw it. I fell again. And that's why I can't do that. I don't want you to fall again. True mercy, true love, once again, if I really love and have true charity for a soul, I want them to get to heaven. And I'll do everything to help them to get to heaven. I will never do anything that's going to condone their sin or keep them in their sin. And believe me, it takes a lot of strength and character to do that as a priest. You don't take joy in doing that. When you go to the doctor, if you have a problem, a wound, he has to make an incision. That's going to hurt. But it's to get the infection out. The same thing with the confessor. I got to uproot this vice for you. And the other thing, my friend, is priests, have a soul too. And I got to get to heaven, too. And there's no way I'm going to commit sins so that you could go to hell, and I'm going to go to hell with you. No way. No way. Number three, he says, another condemned position, ignorance of the mysteries of faith. This is important. And he says, a person is fit for absolution, however much he labors under an ignorance, even culpable. He does not have the mysteries of the Blessed Trinity of the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says, this is condemned. You can't absolve that person until St. Alphonse tells us. My job is then, if I start to get the sense that this person really doesn't understand the faith, and let me tell you something, it's so common today because they haven't taught proper catechesis. People don't know. They haven't, you know, the Pope talks about conscience, 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 but he doesn't give you the whole teaching that you have to have a properly informed conscience. And how do you inform your conscience? You got to study the faith, but the confessor is supposed to help you. When you come in and you start confessing, people come in, they confess sins sometimes, and they'll say, and I start telling them, well, yeah, I got to help you. You got to get rid of it. Wait a minute, that's not a sin. I say, okay, well, let's calm down here. Let's backtrack. What's the confession for? The confess sins. You don't come in here to confess virtues, right? Yeah, all right. So what happened? Why did you confess this if you don't believe it's a sin? Because your conscience is bothering you. Because it goes, we have the natural law written in our hearts in Deuteronomy when our Lord gave the commandments. He said, I've written these on your heart. The Ten Commandments. So the necessary means of faith, I talked to priests. They said, what are you talking about? I don't know that. What is that? You know, all the churches taught, they feed you that you must know that there's one God, he's a good God. Number two, that he sent his son, took flesh, and he redeemed us. He paid the price. He makes redemption possible for our sin. And number three, that the wicked, the just will be rewarded for eternity, and the wicked will suffer for eternity. And then Bellamy and St. Alphonse say you should have some concept, once again, of the Holy Trinity. So I want to go over real quick now, not too quick, but the sacrament of penance. Penance, my friends, is a sacrament in which by the absolution of a confessor, sins committed after baptism are forgiven. For priests have received from Jesus Christ the power of forgiving sins, as appears from the words, whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven. Whose sins you shall retain, they are retained. From the Gospel of John 20, verse 23. The Council of Trent excommunicates all that say the sacrament has not the power to forgive sins. By this sacrament, the sinner recovers not only the divine grace, but also the merits of the good works performed in the state of grace which he lost by mortal sin. This is, you talk about the awesomeness of God and the mercy of God. When you commit a mortal sin, say you're 50, 70 years old, let's just use that as an example, and you accumulate, when you're in a state of sanctifying grace, you collect merit. You're storing your rewards in heaven. And then you commit a mortal sin. All those merits for the past 70 years that you accumulated, they could be tremendous. They're all gone. All gone. And that's justice too. But God's merciful. And when you come into the sacrament, when you're in mortal sin, you can't merit anything. No matter, you could feed the whole world, you could save people, you can't merit when you're in mortal sin. But when you come into the confessional and you do get a valid absolution, God restores all those merits that you accumulated for the past 70 years. How awesome. How awesome. You don't lose it, my friends. The soul also receives additional strength to resist temptation. All the graces we receive through the merits of the passion of Jesus Christ. So you're struggling, you go in there every week, you're working on your prominent vice, you're going to get graces to receive, you receive graces to overcome the temptations. There are three things that are required for a penitent in order for him to receive this holy sacrament. Number one, sorrow for sins committed with the resolve to commit them no more. And this is, once again, you need amendment of life. And this is where one of the biggest problems today, my friends, I could give a whole conference on this, and I do, is recidivist sinners that are abusing the confessional, and shame on the priest, because they haven't been trained, even traditional priests. They absolve in everyone. So if you commit, St. Alphonse says, a mortal sin, and you show sorrow, the priest absolves you, fine. And you do it again, and this is within like a year period, and you fall again, you absolve. And after a third time, he says, after that, the priest, and there's some qualifications, the normal procedure, he has to delay, not deny, delay the absolution. Because you're proving that you don't have amendment of life. And there's people that come to me 30, 40, 50, maybe 60 years, that they start to despair. They begin to think that the sacrament doesn't work. Father, I'm entrenched in this vice. It's driving me crazy. I pray my rosary every day. I go to confession every week. The priest, what does he do? Yeah, he keeps giving me absolution. Don't worry, you'll overcome it. You know, well, he hasn't. So most are invalid, the absolutions after that, until you uproot the vice and truly amend your life. And a priest trained properly, once again, a physician of souls will do that for you. I have people that come back, they literally want to kiss my feet because I helped them uproot the vice. I did what I was taught by the doctor of the church, St. Alphonse, and they are so filled with joy. Because they, Father, I haven't committed sin in a week. And those remedies, my eyes are open. The veil has been taken off. It's beautiful. And I share with every priest I meet about St. Alphonse. And I give them whatever they want. They want to learn. I'll give them the material that I have. And some of them don't. They're afraid to delay and deny. But you know what? Shame on them, because they're going to lose their soul for committing sacrilege. And that's a fact. I'm going to read a story from St. Leonard Portmaurice at the end to show you. So the next is a complete confession of sins committed, which is important, a complete confession. We're going to go over these. And number three, fulfillment of the penance imposed by the confessor. So for the penitent to confess all his sins and conceive a true sorrow for them, he needs to make a careful examination of conscience. In this search, many fail to be too detailed, all right, an examination, and many others by not examining enough. The former are super scrupulous, who are always examining their conscience and are never satisfied. Thus, and this is important, thus they can neglect to excite true sorrow for their sins and a firm purpose of amendment. So it's so important that you have this true sorrow. It is enough for the penitent to be conscientious and apply attention to discover all the sins committed since his last confession. This care and effort must be proportioned to the situation of the penitent. Number one, how long has it been from your last confession? If it's been months, you got to spend more time in examining your conscience, and you're going to forget a lot. Okay, how long? Are you committing mortal sins? Are you committing venial sins? If you're committing mortal sins, you want to make sure you remember all of them. The misfortune is that most Catholics have not many scruples. They commit numberless mortal sins, which they forget. And afterwards, they scarcely confess the sins that occurred to them at the moment of confession. You cannot withhold a sin intentionally from the priest. If you do, you commit sacrilege. You walk out worse than when you walked in. It's a sin against the first commandment. But if you confess your mortal sins and say you tell the priest everything you remember, and when you walk out and all of a sudden you say, oh man, I forgot one. You're covered. You were forgiven. But the next time you go to confession, you're obliged to tell the priest, when I made my last confession, I totally forgot there was another mortal sin. Why? You have to do that so that he could give you penance to make reparation for that sin. So good Catholics make an examination of conscience and an act of contrition every evening at least. And I recommend is you could do what most religious practice in religious life is that you do two examinations of conscience. The one at midday is to rip up your prominent vice. Examine your conscience. Say, I give in to anger. Did I give in to anger today? You examine just that vice. And if you did, you make an act of contrition and you beg our Lord for the grace to overcome that. And that's how you do that. And then at night, you examine your conscience on the whole day, on everything. And then when you go to confession at the end of the week, you're going to be ready, you're going to be prepared, and you'll make a good confession. So thank God for having waited for you then, and beg him to make known to you the number and the grievousness of your sins. So you pray, say, God, you had mercy, especially if you're on mortal sin, that you waited for me. How many people die sudden death? It says in the scriptures, as fish are taken with hooks, so a sin is taken in their sins. Many people die in their sins. And the church tells us that every soul gets all the graces they need to save their soul. Don't ever commit the sin of presumption. And many souls do. Well, I know Father's in the confessional every morning, 8 o'clock before Mass, so I'm going to commit this sin tonight. How do you know you're waking up? How do you know you're not going to get hit by a car? How do you know you're not going to get struck by lightning and have a heart attack? It happens, my friends. It happens. Sister Lucia saw, and the other two seers saw souls falling into hell like snowflakes or leaves off a tree, right? It happens all the time. Then, my friends, go over in your mind the places you have been, the persons you have been with, and the dangerous occasions of sin since your last confession. So, you know, you're hanging out with bad people. Well, when I was with that people, were they telling impure jokes? Were they doing bad things? Did I cooperate with that? Those are grave mortal sins sometimes. And that will help you, okay? Examine all the sins committed by thought, by word, and by deeds. Thought, word, or deeds. If you have a bad thought, an evil thought in your mind, it's not a sin unless you consent to it. But if you do, our Lord says, if you lust after another man's wife in your mind, you commit the sin of adultery. And here, too, you must examine your conscience on sins of omission. Never heard of, everyone leaves that out, the priest, too. Sins of omission brings many souls to hell. This is, you have obligations in your state of life just like I do, and that are obligatory. And if you don't do some of those obligations, not some of them are grave matter. Some of them are grave matter. If you don't do them, those are mortal sins. So you have to examine yourself on that. And then if you did commit a mortal sin, you must go to confession once again immediately. And let me tell you, it's very common when people fall into mortal sin. I said, oh, 2 months. I said, you've been walking around for 2 months in mortal sin. Do you realize that you could have died and went to hell? And run to the confessional, my friends, run. If a person does an action with a doubt whether it was mortal or venial, what kind of sin would he commit? So if you commit a sin and you're doubtful, if I do this, I don't think it's a mortal, what would you be guilty of? You'd be guilty of a mortal sin, St. Alphonse says, because you expose yourself to the dangers of grievously offending God. The sinner, must first resolve the doubt. And if he neglects to do so, he must confess it at least as it appears before God. But scrupulous persons, that's another category, who have doubts about everything, they must just obey their confessor. And St. Leonard Port-Marie said, in theology, the hardest part of theology is being a confessor. Because no two cases are the same. You're dealing with all different people constantly. And so a confessor has to know all these things. St. Alphonse once again recommends that everyone make a general confession if you have not as yet made one. And the church says there's two kinds of general confessions. There's one where you go over your whole life, and the church really recommends to do that, especially when you're going through a change in your vocation. Like say you're going to get married, say you're going to enter the priesthood, take vows in religious life you should make. Towards the end of your life, if you're getting old, you know, and you're up there and you got an illness, I recommend always make a general, you can make a general confession. But if you're scrupulous, that's the worst thing you could do. No confessor should allow you to make a general confession if you're scrupulous. And so these general confessions could be good, but you want to prepare for them properly. And the priest will help you. You study the commandments. You go over your vocation. What's my obligations? You know, if you're a doctor, you got a lot more to examine your conscience in certain areas than somebody else who's a janitor. So it depends on your state of life and what you do. And this is in a general confession, it can really, you got to understand something. To get absolution in the confessional, you don't say you have no sins. All you have to do, go in there and say, bless me, Father, if I have sin. I'd like to renew my sorrow for a past sin I committed against the fifth commandment, say. Guess what? You get a ton of grace. These priests that yell at people with venial sins, they don't know what they're talking about. They're coming in there. They're coming in. You're getting grace. You're building up your church. If I said every time you come in my confession, I'm going to give you 10 grand. Man, I'd line be here from California. But God's giving you treasures of graces. And so this is important. You want to take advantage of it. So sorrow for sins is so necessary for obtaining forgiveness that without it, even God himself cannot pardon sin. Not even God could pardon you if you don't have sorrow. In Luke 13:3, it says, unless you shall do penance, you shall all likewise perish. And here is the mistake of those who prepare for confession, endeavor only to call to mind their sins, but make no effort to arrive at true sorrow for them. We must pray to God, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and your holy guardian angel to help us to have true sorrow. That's what you do. Help me. I really want to understand. Read about the Passion. Study the Passion. See what your sins have done to Christ. That you have crucified him. I have crucified him. And if you do that, you'll develop true sorrow for our Lord. You'll grow, have a deep relationship with him, and you'll truly love him. You won't want to offend him. To obtain forgiveness for our sins in the sacrament of penance, and you should be writing these things down, okay? Our sorrow for them must have five conditions. Five conditions. Number one, our sorrow must be sincere. It must not be only from the lips, but also in the heart. The soul must conceive a true sorrow, a true displeasure, a regret, and from the heart. True heartfelt repentance. He must hate and abhor his sins. So important. Number two, sorrow must be supernatural. It must arise not from a natural, but from a supernatural motive. It would not be sufficient to repent of your sins because it has harmed your health, your property, or your reputation. The motive then of our sorrow must be supernatural. We must repent of our sins either on account of its deformity and brutality, or because it has offended the infinite goodness of God, or because by it we have deserved hell or lost heaven. Number three, our sorrow must be sovereign. This does not mean that it must be accompanied with tears and positive physical feelings. Okay, it is enough if it is a deliberate determination of the will that one would wish he had suffered any positive evil rather than having offended God. Saint Teresa has given an excellent method for knowing whether a soul has true sorrow for sin. And I quote her, if one has a sincere purpose to sin no more and would be content to lose all things rather than the grace and friendship of God, let him have confidence, for then there is no doubt that he has true sorrow for his sins. We got to strive for that, my friends. We have to strive for that. Number four, our sorrow must be universal, extending to everything that could cut us off from God's friendship for such evil. We must hate above all evils, mortal sin. Must hate it. Deep hatred. If you're struggling with a vice, saving impurity, beg Our Lady, say, please give me the grace to have such a hatred for this sin that I'd rather die in the state of sanctifying grace than ever commit that again. Die. So many times when I have delayed absolution on sins, penitence, and some of them do get mad, but then they come back and they say, I was so embarrassed, and I'm still shocked that you did it. And I said, I have one question. Would you commit that a sin again? Never. I said, oh, my job's accomplished, man. Praise God. Never. If one confesses, this is really important now, nothing but venial sins, because believe me, there are good souls, and the priest, the sacrament of confession is so awesome. A good priest is always humbled in that confessional. When you get a holy soul in there, oh, man, it humbles you, and it uplifts you to see that there are souls that love Christ. They don't want to commit sin, even a slightly deliberate venial sin. They'd rather die. That should be our attitude. St. Teresa of Avila says that we have to fear venial sins, especially deliberate ones. And she says, if you don't, if you keep on committing them, eventually you will fall into mortal sin and you won't run to the confessional. So we want to hate this sin, even venial. So if one confesses nothing but venial sins and only venial sins for which they lack due sorrow, remember that their confessions are null, they're not valid. That absolution wouldn't be valid. So when they wish to receive absolution, they must have sorrow for at least some of the venial sins that they confess, or must accuse themselves of some sins of their past life for which they are sincerely sorry. So when I follow St. Alphonse, when I have penitents in my confessional, and they come all the time, I train them. I said, when you confess, you say like this, Father, please, you know, forgive me for all these sins and all the sins of my past, even the ones that I've forgotten. And I renew my sorrow for past mortal sins, if you have any, against, all you have to do is name the number, fifth commandment, sixth commandment. And that brings good contrition. And you get more grace. You get more grace. And that's not being scrupulous. Okay? Say, but with regards to mortal sin, it is necessary to have true sorrow for all of them and a sincere purpose not to commit them again. Otherwise, no sin, mortal or venial, will be pardoned. Number five, our sorrow must be trustful, that is hopeful of pardon. Otherwise, it will be like the sorrow of the damned, who are sorry for their sins not because they are offenses against God, but because they are the cause of their sufferings. And their sorrow is without hope of pardon. The great doctor, St. Francis de Sales, says that the sorrow of true penitence is a sorrow full of peace and consolation. For the more a true penitent grieves for having offended God, the greater his confidence of obtaining pardon and the greater his consolation. And so you have to have that hope. Know that God paid the price for the sins. You will be absolved. The absolution will be valid if you have all these things that we're talking about here, an amendment of life. It's beautiful. St. Francis tells you, when you come out of that confessional, and if you don't have some joy and you're uneasy and you made a good confession, it's a sign that the devil's come. He's trying to rob your peace. It's not from God, that. It is necessary also to know that sorrow for sins is of two kinds, perfect contrition and imperfect contrition, or attrition we call it. Perfect contrition is a sorrow for sin because it is an offense against the divine goodness, perfect act of love we call it. Imperfect contrition or attrition is a sorrow for having offended God when the soul conceives it from a less perfect motive than imperfect contrition. Such as a consideration of the hideousness of sin or of the damage done to us by sin, that is, for our having deserved hell or of having lost heaven. Let it be observed that in the act of imperfect contrition, it is not enough for a sinner to merely repent because he deserves hell. He also must repent of having offended God and thus deserving hell. So you have to have that. You're sorry because you offended God. The Council of Trent requires a sorrow of soul and a detestation of sin, along with the purpose of sinning no more. The soul cannot have true sorrow for sin without a sincere resolve never again to cut oneself off from God's friendship. Now, in order to have this, to be a true, worthy resolve, it must have three conditions. Number one, it must be firm, so that the penitent resolutely is determined to suffer every evil rather than offend God. There is no excuse for those who consent to sin. Repeat, there is no excuse for those who consent for sin. For if they recommend themselves to God, he will stretch out his hand and support them, and they will not fall. He then who falls into sin falls through his own fault, either because he will not beg God to help him, or because he will not avail himself of the help which the Lord offers to him. The purpose, number three, the purpose of amendment must be universal. That is, it must be a purpose of avoiding everything that cuts us off from God's friendship, mortal sin. Number three, we must practice all the means needed to avoid sin. And one of the most necessary of these means is to shun the occasion of relapsing into sin. This is the most important point. Shun the occasion. Flee from the occasion. St. Alphonse Liguori tells you, if you don't flee the occasion, you will fall. I don't care if you're a saint. You have to flee. You have to flee. And if you do that, you won't commit sins. He says, were men careful to shun evil occasions, oh, how many sins would they abstain from, and thus how many more souls would escape damnation? But when a person voluntarily exposes himself to occasions of sin, particularly sins of impurity, it is very probable that he may fall. Okay, very probable. It is necessary to distinguish between approximate occasion of sin and from remote. A remote occasion is that kind to which all are exposed or which men seldom fall into. A proximate occasion is that which per se ordinarily induces one to sin. An occasion in which a person has frequently fallen before is called proximate. Okay? But occasions which are not proximate for others may be proximate for a particular person who, on account of his wounded disposition or on account of his bad habits, has frequently fallen into sin. No one can receive absolution unless he firmly resolves to shun occasions of sin because he exposes himself to such occasions. Though sometimes he might fall, is for him a mortal sin. And when the occasion is voluntary and is constantly present threat, the penitent cannot be absolved unless he has actually removed the occasion of sin. And if they do not take it away before they receive absolution, they will scarcely remove it after they have been absolved. You have to flee the occasion. You have to remove it, okay? And if you say you're an alcoholic, and don't listen to nonsense AA says. AA is from hell, my friends. You don't send anyone to AA. It begins with lies. Alcohol is a disease. It's not a disease. It's a sin. It's an act of your will. Can you become addicted? Your body, yes, but you flick that on yourself. And so, for instance, if a man's an alcoholic and he goes to the bar and says, I'm just going to drink Coca-Cola, and it happens a lot, well, how long is he going to drink Coca-Cola for? Eventually, he's going to drink. But just walking into that bar is a mortal sin because he's putting himself at risk. At risk. And you could apply that to anything else. If the occasion of sin is necessary, there are necessary occasions, and you cannot, which is one that you cannot remove, then you must at least adopt the means of making it remote. What are these means? Number one, to frequent the sacraments of penance and perhaps the Eucharist if you're in grace. Number two, prayer, penance. And number three, avoiding familiarity with the persons with whom you have sinned. Say a man's having an affair with a woman where he works and he just can't quit his job. He's supporting his family. And so what do you do? I said, no, I can't quit. I said, okay, we have to make this approximate occasion remote. So I don't ever want you to pass her desk no more. I don't want you to converse with her. You got to teach the people how to do these things. But when the penitent, after adopting all these means, would still relapse, what is the last remedy? Our Lord himself gives us the answer. If thy right eye scandalize thee, cause thee to offend, pluck it out and cast it from thee. Because you're going to go to hell. I get these people on the computers. Forget about it. I start, get a proper server that doesn't allow. Get a program that doesn't allow. Let someone else. But I always say, are you a computer geek? Because if you are, then you're going to get by the code. Now I got to give it. And then if that person keeps falling after that, I said, now you got to, I don't care. Even if you need it for your living, in a sense, because you will lose your soul then. If you can't overcome it with the remedies I'm giving you, you will lose your soul. Get rid of the computer. Rip it out. And I tell you, when I give people remedies for their sins, their proper sins, especially the impure ones, and I never had one penitent, because I follow St. Alphonse, come back, that was sincere, that follows those remedies, that has not been delivered from their sins. And when they come back, they say, oh, I still fell. I said, you do the, oh, yeah. I said, no, you didn't do all the remedies. You did 2 out of 4 or 5? No. Do all of them. And if you're really sorry, you will do them. So the penitent is obliged in confessing his sins to have the intention of complying with the penance imposed by the confessor. What sort of sin is it not to perform the penance imposed by a confessor? If the penance is light, the omission of it is a venial sin. If great, it is a mortal sin. If the fulfillment of the penance is signed to become very difficult, it may be changed by another, by the same or another confessor. The penance must be performed with the time fixed by the confessor and should not, and he should, and if he, excuse me, and if he should fix a time, it ought to be performed soon. So you have to do your penance to, you know, for the, it's part of the confession. And the penance, once again, you know, St. Alphonse teaches the priest, once again, the wisdom of this doctor is unbelievable. He says, you get penitents, I get a penitent that's been away 40, 50 years, and that happens a lot. When they come in and confess them, and it's going to be a long confession usually, because I want to make sure we cover everything. The Pope says you're not supposed to interrogate. I got quotes from him that are here too about that. Sometimes a priest is obliged to interrogate, if you want to call interrogate, but question a penitent, because I don't want you to commit a sacrilege. And I got to say, well, how many times did you commit that mortal sin? You just can't, and I have to do that. So you have to interrogate. And then sometimes when it comes to the penance, you have to give a penance that fits the thing. So if you committed 50 years of mortal sins, I can't even give you technically a penance that's going to make up for it in one sense. So what you do is you work with them. You try to get them, you know, when you commit grave sin like that, you needed, you know, like rosaries, this, that. And, you know, so I encourage them. So I said, are you capable of doing, I'll draw out a penance. And they'll say, no. Well, I work with them. And you could tell, you test their disposition. And sometimes St. Alphonse says, what you have to do is give twofold penance as a priest. Twofold penance. This is brilliant. The first one is mandatory. And you explain, you have to do this for your confession. And I give it. You must say two rosaries if there's been some bad stuff, right, or whatever. Do the station. But what I recommend is part B is optional, but I highly recommend it. I recommend you continue to do rosary every day for the rest of your life, but it's optional. And you make sure they understand. And I said, do you understand what I'm saying? You walked them through. You don't want them to be confused. And I tell penitents, if a priest puts a penance on you, which is overburdened, don't walk out and say, Father, please, really, I just think that's, I won't be able to do it. Because I have people telling me, sometimes they walk, come across, one person for venial sin, the priest gave him 14 stations of the cross. I'm like, whew, you know? You know, so, but a priest can commute that and say no, you know. So these things happen. And I know we're running out of time and they're going to get mad at me, but I want to read to you just to enforce this, because I like to give conferences just on this. But St. Leonard of Port Maurice, get this book for your confessor. He tells a story at the end. And here it is. He says, a certain man of rank who lived in the proximate occasion of sin with a depraved female had found, to his great misfortune, a confessor singularly complacent and ever ready to give him absolution. This gentleman's wife, a lady of great piety, failed not from time to time to stimulate the conscience of her husband and to lead him to suspect the validity of all those absolutions thus given without the proximate occasion being removed. He only turned her efforts into ridicule. He says to her, do you want to become a theologian? He said to her, take care of your own soul. Leave me to my own. If my confessor was not warranted in absolving me, he would not do it. He continued to live just as before and to confess after the same fashion. And at his death, his confession was in keeping with those he had been accustomed to make enjoying life. One day, his widow engaged in prayer in her oratory, when all of a sudden she saw before her a monster in human shape, surrounded with flames and borne on the shoulders of another man. The good lady would have fled, and she heard, stop! He cried out to her, know that I am the soul of your husband condemned to hell, and that he who bears me is the confessor. We both are damned. I for making unworthy confessions, and he for unworthily absolving me. He then disappeared. This is a saint. They don't lie, saints. This is a true story. And this is why it's so important that you get the word out to priests. Get him this book. You don't have to tell him he doesn't notice. I gave you a nice little gift here, you know. And it will do you wonders. So St. Leonard goes on to say, he goes, our ministry, my dear sirs, he's talking to priests, is one of great labor and trouble. How sad if it only serves to conduct the souls of our penitents the more readily into hell.
How sad, I repeat, how very, very sad. Well, since it is thus, someone perhaps will say, let him who will devote himself to the labor of the confessional. As for me, I will look to my own soul and not expose myself to all this danger. And he goes, what? And is this the fruit you derive from your from our conference? Truly, I am amazed. Is this how you appreciate the opportunity of cooperating in the salvation of souls so dear to God? What occupation can you find more noble, more heroic, more holy than the aiding and saving souls? The most divine of things divine is to cooperate with God in the salvation of souls. My friends, let us pray to Our Lady of Fatima to renew the priesthood, to renew the holy sacrament of penance, that people will realize how important it is, that you will find holy confessors like St. John Vianney, St. Pio, that will help you uproot your vice, get you to heaven, that you, through those confessionals, will end up loving God more, and you will serve him. And when you die, you will hear those beautiful words from our Lord. Welcome, welcome. And I'm telling you, my friends, this is so important. Pray for this. Pray for the renewal of this, because believe me, many, many souls are going to hell because of bad confessing and bad confessors. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen.